It is Thursday, May 1, 2008. I'm in Detroit with artists Fernando Colorón, Bertha Cohen, and Graciela Bustos of the artist group Los Dialeguistas. This is Judith Wakuha from the University of Dayton, here to interview these three about their collaborative efforts. Let's begin just by a brief introduction. Each one of you, who you are, where you came from, how long you've been here, and how long you've been involved in art making.
Well, I'm involved in art making all my life. My name is Fernando Calderón. I'm from Peru, Lima, Peru. I came to the United States 20 years ago. From there, from the day one, I started working here. I use the CCS place for doing my work in the beginning. After that, I have a studio. I start working for many different people as I met in all these years. Commissions, try survive. My media is anything. I can use any material for express myself. I love working in wood. That is what all my big pieces are made for. And also, now I during love doing installations, which I think is such a wonderful thing for express yourself. So I'm working in that now. Plus, I continue working in my sculptures also. Only I think we are a group which really every day is growing and growing more. This is the Dialoguistas.
Okay. I'm Graciela Bustos. I'm from Colombia, and I have been in the States for more than 30 years. I came here because of my family, and I raised my family, I went to the university and studied art, and I have been working really, like Fernando said, all my life in art, creating and raising my family, and now that I have more time to do my work, I'm working more. And I was lucky to find Fernando and Berta, and we formed the group, the Dialoguistas, and we have been working for 10 years and doing installations and performance, and I love this, the idea of doing ephemeral work, something that is not permanent. It's very interesting to me. As a group, we have been every year we know that we have been growing, and we have more like working together. It triples our energy and our creativity, and it's the work grows every time that we go together. It's more rewarding. So I'm very happy to be in the group, and I hope to continue working with them and to do more installations and different kinds of projects.
Which university did you study at?
I went to Eastern Michigan University.
Very good.
I went to the Catholic University in Peru. It's a very big university, which is also in Spain. So I have the best teachers. Adolfo Winternix was one of the more big muralist and also vitralist. Anna Macagno, which was an Italian woman, with her husband was an ambassador. She came to Peru and she tried doing her work. She was one of my teachers. She died 4 years ago, and we have a wonderful show with Joy, all her students giving something to her, and I sent a piece to the Italian Museum in Peru, and was showing that in that show for her homage.
Berta Cova, Brazilian. I have been in this country for almost 50 years, and I have been doing art for a long, long time. And I'm a multimedia artist, including writing and theater, poetry in the writing department. I sing, but mostly I paint. And after many years of exploring this medium, which I absolutely adore, I had the good luck to be invited to join the Dialogistas. And as Graciela Bustos mentioned, every year, every project enriches our experience, I would say our knowledge of this world, what we want to say, and to synthesize all these experiences, to simplify. I feel that installations is a fantastic medium. It's, as Graciela mentioned, and Fernando too, it's ephemeral, it's site-specific, we're considering the surroundings, the physical aspects of the space that we are showing, and this opens up each time different challenges and possibilities. I think we're in the right direction.
How is it that you all came to collaborate? Were you searching for something outside of just your individual studio practice?
No, we start doing each one different pieces for a show. In one point, we start thinking this is not the way we are going to be a group. The way is going to be three minds, one piece. So there is was born the Dialogistas. We start working and talking every week and doing conversations about what we are going to do in the future and all that. There is was every idea born. We start working together for one piece only. So that was our idea.
It was also very interesting that we start working when we were at the same professional level, intellectually. Also, we wanted to, and also we have chemistry. We enjoy working together. It's fun. It's not, for me, it's not work. It's extremely, it's so much fun that.
It's our therapy.
Yeah, it's very interesting working together because of the way that we understand each other and we complement it, and it's fun. And I feel that if I can use the word expression, the term sacrificing egos, which are big things among artists,
yes.
We all know.
Yes.
This took a lot of thought and acceptance on our part, and this unity is what makes it work, that we are not three but one.
Well, give a little bit of history about that unification of your creative
minds. Well, as Fernando explained, we started doing pieces, even though we were installations, we had several individual pieces.
Back in 92?
When we 10
years ago,
approximately.
Okay.
As the time passed, we reduced to one. We feel that one piece.
It was a process. It was
a
difficult process. It was
a very difficult process for we fighting in the beginning each
fighting
other.
Fighting for individuality.
About,
we wanted to do
yes.
Different. We did a show in Chicago, and it was a big show, but we had
was
so many different pieces.
Yeah, it was a
and
collage.
And we worked so
collage.
Hard, and it was not a good show because it was not cohesive. It was not
yeah.
There to have unity, and really, what this was the first.
Towers.
Show that we did.
Name it and date it. 2001 Noticias?
Noticias.
Yeah,
yes.
2001 Noticias. It was the first work that when we arrived at.
One piece.
To do one piece.
Only.
And it was very satisfying. It felt good.
That is where
so
we found
started.
Our way. That is where we say This is what we want. Yeah. It's only doing together. One piece together.
So, unfold the development of this piece. How did you come together on a theme, on materials, the actual development of the work, and the making of the work?
We wanted to work with paper, something light, and we wanted to have something universal. So we found that newspapers, we collected newspapers for months from all over the world, and the actual, this is a site specific. We went to the gallery and we...
Which gallery?
That was in Detroit.
Mary Grove College in Detroit, Michigan.
Very good.
And
we love this space.
We did a maquette.
Yeah.
And of the piece. And so from that, we knew about the sizes and the relationship of the space with the piece. So we started working for months. We have
rolling.
People helping us. We pay people to help us because we roll about 20,000 newspapers.
Rolls of newspapers.
So
yeah.
They were intertwined
in a solid unit. It's not hollow, it's a completely solid unit. So it's hundreds of pounds and ways that we need to transport this stuff. I remember we rent the more big truck to take all this there and install all the pieces. Was amazing. Was days of work.
Yeah.
Only in Puddy Towers.
How tall are these towers?
Eight feet.
And they're interwoven. Do you mean these rolls of newspaper were braided? How did they
No, it was like
together?
one
layer.
Layer,
one layer
was this way.
Horizontal,
the other layer was this
vertical,
way.
Almost like a building a house,
yeah.
Bricks.
When did you glue them?
And
we glued them together.
Mm-hmm. It was the only way for in the beginning we thinking in put together. Was the idea born? I remember we don't want to use glue. We don't want to use any other material. We are going to build that thing in the place. So we start put together one piece and we take hours and hours and say, no, this is impossible. We need.
Yeah, it was glue.
Yeah, was
in a lot of your pieces that I've seen, there are hours and hours and hours of intricate, delicate, very high craftsmanship attention to building and making the piece.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of repetition.
Yes.
So we'll think about that, talk about that. But you have this ephemeral material, newspaper. You have language and the urge to communicate on a worldwide scale because you've collected newspapers from around the world.
Exactly.
It's light, it's ephemeral, it's spoken, it's changing. And you create these huge preponderant structures
mm-hmm.
with the newspapers.
Mm-hmm.
What was your intention? What was your feeling about why you selected these materials and this size and this kind of...
This was like a communication. It's communication.
And also from something so light and delicate...
Make it something so
strong.
And
big.
And
yeah.
The challenge of the words, the written word in the newspapers.
Mm-hmm.
How we discovered them as we worked with
you
them.
You can still read some paragraphs from the site.
Snippets of
news.
Course, all the news and everything that goes on in the world and opinion, etc.
Mm-hmm.
So this was a sort of revelation to the artist and obviously to the viewer. So
yes,
lots of contemplation.
Like a little end.
Little secrets.
All these buildings and towers and stuff is so heavy. Yeah, was all our work is challenge. All our work is a challenge. Always we start with challenging each other, what we are going to do and all that. So that is what became all the ideas.
And a lot of attention to detail.
Detail is important.
Yeah, we want it to be as perfect as we can do it.
Mm-hmm.
What about this attention to detail? What does it mean for you?
Is
that everything is important.
Yeah, it's not doing something and cover after. No, we want
there is an
joining
honesty,
inside
Fernando, an honesty. Mm-hmm. That's the word I think. Mm-hmm. An honesty about the process. No escaping. No shortcuts.
Yeah.
Not with this group.
No.
And it's like
and always something new.
Yeah, like you say, it's not a cover up.
No,
because
we don't want
you
cover
from
anything.
From the inside out,
exactly.
It's like a body inside. You have inside. It's not hollow. So we work like that. We take it from the beginning and from the inside and goes out. So what you see outside is not everything. It has
it's
inside,
the inside too.
Too.
Yeah.
That seems that you don't see,
mm-hmm.
but they are there.
Something about really reflecting lived experience, organic lived experience.
Yes, yes. We love form. We love space. We love sound.
So you came away from this piece. It's ephemeral. It was deinstalled. What did you do next? Was this, you know, the firming up of your commitment to one another to stay engaged in collaboration? Did it take a while and some offer from some gallery to call you back as a collaborative group?
No, because
we're always working.
We're always working.
We're not
media.
Waiting for... I know artists suffer about showing his work and don't have the place for that. Only, excuse me, the thing is, we always work, for we don't want to stop. So
we
have our meetings every week.
And we talk and we think and we do.
We have lots of ideas.
That's when we came out about a language. We didn't have any specific show to
We want to do something different.
As Graciela said, it comes from the chance and you grab it, you recognize it.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the beauty. It's very mysterious, this creative.
It's like a child education.
It is very mysterious. You don't know what there is.
Really no explanation, but you have to be at it.
Mm-hmm.
I suppose there's everything
and
else.
Every time that we meet and that we are working, we something good will come out.
Exactly.
Like if we don't meet, we are not working and we have no ideas. But if when we meet, the individual ideas, they come together and we always agree on something to do.
We take a note.
We are extension of each other.
Mm-hmm.
We complete each other's sentences. Why not? It's like a marriage.
Yes.
A good marriage.
Yes. And we're not afraid to say anything.
And
we are
ourselves. We are totally free.
Say anything. Completely free. We're not embarrassed to anything. So
and not offended and not
take
it personally. All this comes with time.
Yeah.
It sounds like a lot of growth is offered
for
each
and
one
the
individuals of you
too.
In this very collaborative process.
Exactly.
Yes.
Including your own lives, your family lives, etc.
We know so much each other. We know about what she's doing, what Graciela's doing, with thinking, what we're going to do. It's almost like a family. It's a family.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's a family. It's amazing how much we can know each other all these years. At the beginning was difficult, very difficult for Graciela.
Mm-hmm.
Have a character, Berta
personality.
We are completely different. We three persons completely opposed.
But the only thing that we have in common, we love art.
Yes.
And we are passionate. So
yeah.
I found in Fernando and Berta a lot of passion, and I do have a lot of passion for that. So it's very difficult to find somebody like with this passion that you can put the world together. It's difficult.
And that must feed your own energy for making.
It feeds our own energy.
So after Noticias, what did you do? Is that when you did the language?
After
you, how did your invented language evolve?
We were meeting.
Start like a plane. Like
plane,
a star
plane.
Plane.
Alpha Omega Alpha came after, as we want to cite.
Yeah,
to
but with Alpha Omega Alpha, we already had the language. We invented the language.
Oh, yeah.
We were meeting in her kitchen, and we had a recorder. And then we start.
We start joking,
and then
talking birds, and we say, you know, when we came to this country, where I not
understood.
Speak and I don't understand any single thing.
So that's where
we start talk completely wrong. Completely
that nobody will understand.
Nobody understands. Yeah,
and
I
so
say
we
I remember.
We start taking these conversations, and it was
so funny.
Funny. It
so
was
funny.
By the beginning.
Yeah.
And then we came out with the words, and we start writing this language. So when we did the book, we had the language
we
in
do,
the book.
She put together all the poems.
With the poems, and we
yeah.
did
the photos.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Of work.
So it became a language, our language.
The book specifically had poetry as the literary part.
So you were talking, all of you realizing you came to the United States having difficulty with language and
mm-hmm.
with communication. Your background, you were probably raised knowing three languages?
Even more. Yeah, because of the parents being European and the associations. And, of course, the Latin. If you know Portuguese, you know...
So Portuguese,
Italian,
Spanish, English...
You understand at
French,
least.
Italian, okay.
Yeah, German, Yiddish.
So your idea was somebody is in the center of that all that say what are you doing here? I don't know anything. What is he saying to me? What
it's terrible.
It's a very hard
I
remember my
left.
2 years I was in very hard way and I feel so bad about I can speak, I can know what he is talking about me, what is
We want to bypass these difficulties
mm-hmm.
of languages. This is important, obviously, for the regular life. But in art, why can't we have the luxury to have
to write in whatever we want
that are our own and that don't need to be explained, don't
mm-hmm.
need to be understood, but could be felt?
Mm-hmm.
Like universal language.
It follows the artistic process. Eliminating all these things that are not important for the piece. No difficulties. Just the actual act of making art. The language was one part of it, one component.
Mm-hmm.
So you started writing words. You said
yes.
You started making words.
Mm-hmm.
We started joking, speaking, almost making fun of ourselves. And then it, you know, it's, hey, this is very interesting. We taped it.
Yeah.
And then we wrote it.
Don't forget, it's not only the words. There's intonation and there's musicality.
Thank you. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
This is what makes it so interesting. It's complete.
You have words of 20 letters.
You don't need a guitar. You don't need a. It is all that we are. The three of us equipped with all these elements. And we feel that this is a real strong common denominator for us to pursue, to continue. It will never leave us. It's already there. Wherever, whatever we do, will be related to with the language.
What I hear, though, is that you start looking at language as abstract form that has color qualities, formal qualities, sharpness,
rhythmic,
softness,
yeah,
like a visual form. So you
yeah,
begin
exactly.
to explore it in
exactly.
the same formal, abstract ways. Tell me about
mm-hmm.
that exploration, because this is unfamiliar territory for many artists and art critics. Speak more to that exploration. You record it. You begin to try to write it.
It became an installation.
To make it.
That was an installation.
It's the natural instinct. The animal grunts or makes noises. We are animals.
Mm-hmm.
And we are in the domain. We need to explore everything that we are doing. Our psychics, our hands. Why not vocal?
So the installation...
If you stop for a moment, you will hear. Nature, you will hear so much. You will hear birds, you hear noises, onomatopoeic, all these things. So that's incorporated, each one.
We love the natural sounds, the natural sounds outside. We don't, I personally, I don't listen too much music. I have the music outside.
Yeah.
is always I hear.
When and you're Graciela driving, too. He doesn't like
we are. It's so funny for Graciela and I, we are the same. We're working
silent.
With silent. We have our own sound. So it's like a bubble for us every time I'm working. I remember some other friends which I have working with music and loud music, like my other friend, and TV and all that stuff, and I can't.
No, I had radio, I had classical, always classical radio.
Berta loved listening to
Carl Haas, that I learned so much from him. But I remember starting a piece, and everything else disappeared, no sound, no Carl Haas. And when I finished the piece, Carl Haas came again.
Mm-hmm.
That means that interval was totally absorbed in the creative process.
And many people will relate to this. They can recall having moments where their intensity is so focused.
Intensity, focus.
We disconnect from the outside and we are ourselves.
Well, these are the compositions.
Selfish.
The rest is not so easy.
Muse.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Yeah. We are selfish. I work for a really one feel myself. I want be myself. I don't care about any single thing outside. Yeah. It's how I feel.
And yet you're able to merge this drive for self with this collaborative effort that has been so productive.
Yes.
So your installation about the language, your first installation.
That was in Croatia. We do a book. We put together a book.
Tell us how you got to Croatia.
At the Museum of Modern Art in Zagreb.
We were invited. Yeah, we were invited for that show. So we start thinking what we are going to bring there. We can bring a big piece for really is one expensive and difficult. So we say, why we don't put together all our pictures and we start, for we always thinking and doing a book. Always our dream our dream is
to do more
in one point doing videos and books. That is our dream. So we think, why we don't do our book? So we put together a book and this stayed long time. Was a big process, long process. I now work with computers and Graciela started taking classes of computer. My partner is know about computer.
We did the book ourselves.
We want to do every single thing ourselves. So we have a meetings in my house, in Graciela's house, in Berta's. Always we are have the meetings and we start put together all these pieces, which was many pages of sometimes nothing, for we don't have nothing. And in one point, she start writing all the poems. Graciela start taking pictures. I start fighting with my partner for doing put together this in the computer. So was amazing the process. Yeah, it was
That's a difficult
exciting.
Lesson. Yeah, it's very complicated, but we did it.
Yeah,
and that's what.
And we also work with defined materials. Sometimes we spend lots of money in the materials. We find a wonderful. Paper which is completely acid-free and all that stuff. We want to work with something with the best.
That's another advantage of working together. We triple our money too because it's we collaborate with the money too, because sometimes it's very expensive to.
Yes, this is a book of color prints. What kind of prints? Iris, laser jet.
Where did people?
I remember it.
Oh, you remember the book, no?
Is it iris print or what kind of actual printing of the images, the photographic images?
What is the subject of the photographs?
No, what print did you use?
We use Epson 2200. I know.
Okay.
That is the printer which do all this, and the paper is called Vellum. No, it's called
Vellum.
The paper is velvet.
Velvet.
It's a cold velvet. It's completely acid-free. It's archival. You can print for both. That was our thing. We find paper to print one side only. And we start research. We need the two sides, but we want to print ourselves. We don't want to take it for... We went to different printers, and one charged so much money. So we start looking, and we find the paper.
Yeah. This book is 20 by 15, and it's bound, hard bound.
Yeah.
Who bound it for you?
We went to the best.
In an arbor, a lady did it for us.
Okay. Yeah, this is...
Right. It's very beautiful. And how many editions do you have?
One.
2003. But you have some mock-ups, right?
No.
Just this one. Okay.
Just this one. We have everything in the computer to do. Okay.
Or when we want one piece only.
We wanted to find also a printer.
I know. Yeah. Somebody was one interesting in print the book. So
describe the images and the creation of the images.
These images from the book?
Yes, and then we'll go to the text, or you can juggle both at the same time.
These images came from the from another piece that we did in CCS, from the burn paper.
Alpha, Omega, Alpha.
Yeah, we burned thousands of pages of newspaper, and then from these, not ashes, but with the left of the paper that was burned, I photographed these images, but I photographed just tiny little spaces. And
Using lenses.
I only used...
Using like a macro lens?
Yeah. Yes. I only used the natural light. So from this burnt paper, there was an immense variety of...
Forms, angles, and colors.
Like and a landscape.
It was amazing.
Beautiful abstractions.
Yeah.
Beautiful abstractions. And it depends on the light of the day. I can get different colors. And if I have, like, if I work in the garden, I can get a little bit of colors.
She was the photographer.
Yeah. It's
funny, for we are not feel bad about we not doing something, for we are only one person. With the three, we are one person. So... She was the
photographer. But also, I took the photograph and they look at it and said, this is good, this is not good, this so we can use this. And
we criticize. Berta and I, we criticize.
Yeah, yeah.
She take the photos. She was the eye for this book. So that was amazing. It's always, we have something, we collaborate. And Berta put together all the poems.
So then the words become poems. And you're crafting these words together and sharing.
Looking at the particular image, you get feedback. Maybe. I have it in my head, hopefully, by now. With so much digestion, so many months of dealing with the subject matter. You are the subject matter already, but you have to have maybe a starting point or something like that. So you begin to do poems. Then you do poems in it. Abstract, just like you do an abstract.
Oh, and there's a photograph of the written page of the poem. This is a huge book, huge print, and it's just filled with writing.
These are statements.
These are statements.
Thoughts, mementos about the project, etc.
Inner language.
Inner language. Using this language.
In your invented language, you are using your invented language.
Actually, very autobiographical. Why not?
Did you all take the opportunity to use the language, or were you?
We all did. Each one of us wrote. This happens to be my page. I recognize my own handwriting.
And the flow is so distinctive. The flow of the language is like stream of consciousness.
Yes,
right?
It is.
Just fills. It is. And yet there's a minuteness again, an intricacy, a commitment to this process that looks like it goes on and on and on and on. That's like
this can go on.
You're making an earlier
process.
Yeah, you don't have to stop.
Repetition of minute.
But this can go, this flow will go as
you
much
stop.
As we want. There was no end.
No limit.
No limits.
And then there are
capsules of poetry. Tsum. Kadusa on Nichi Tsuruk omni giorno da tutata a sendoke capelluke cetesi e tusolguti cat cosa non faco apiapi rica salutino raca a caplar raca catuva gli anni sta puteta e nu indut sur il cara cor.
Wonderful.
Could be preaching, could be
sensation.
Confiding, all these qualities, you take it as you want. How many superfluous words you hear people talk about? There are none here.
And sometimes people talk and you don't understand.
I think it's utopian. And there is obviously a rhythm to it, as everything in life. So this was a very interesting project.
And that was in the in Croatia, in the museum, modern art.
Why a book?
Why a book? For
this exhibit? For you as artist.
It's physical, yeah. Physically to transport it. It was easy to have a small contained piece. We had some photos, bigger photos too, in the walls. But mostly this was highlighted.
Your history as a collaborative group has been that you do installation where you go in and you perform. So the work is experiential, it's ephemeral, as you said. The act of reading is in the moment, it's ephemeral. You're in it and then you close the book and the experience is gone, but it's not gone. You carry it with you. It's interactive, like so many of your installations that you did at University of Dayton. People were invited to interact with the work. And a book is interactive. It requires the participation of the viewer.
This was displayed with a plexiglass stand with people can touch and people can open the pages.
With gloves.
It's very fine. Yeah. It's very fine.
So that was an installation for that place.
A book is often also creates a landscape of images in one's mind as you're reading the words. And the very first time I saw this book, it looked to me like the ash that you photographed was creating some kind of abstract landscape. Now, you've shown me the videotape that you've created of Alpha, Omega, Alpha.
Mm-hmm.
If we could talk about that as its own piece and then its relationship to this book. But I was caught with, again, the beautiful footwork done with the digital camera, is it?
Mm-hmm.
The video camera?
Yes.
Yeah, the video camera, I believe, was done by a professional.
So the movements and the speed of the camera as it goes around this, what I can only assume, it's somewhat abstract, huge amassing of charred ashes.
Yeah.
It looks as if you're moving around a landscape.
Yeah.
But also, again, the timing of the camera movement itself is continual, somewhat constant. The speed changes maybe 3 times, but it's like a beautiful flow, the movement of the camera. And then the wonderful disruptive flow of this landscape of images. So, how would you describe the materials, why you made them look this way? What feelings or ideas were you trying to evoke with very black, charred ashes?
It was, we did that, the size of the piece, it was according to the gallery. It was
35 feet long by, I think, in 30 by 35.
Yeah, it was 30 by 35 feet long, and it was divided into squares. And each square was a mound of the burnt paper. It was not, I don't call ashes because it was burnt paper. The paper still had the forms.
Yes.
And sometimes you can even read the newsprint. So when we work in this piece, We burn paper for months outside in the summer. And it depends on the weather, the humidity, and we can have the right amount of fire that if the day, for example, if the day was humid, the paper didn't burn to ashes. When the day was very hot, we couldn't get anything. It became ashes. So we have to pay attention to the humidity, to the weather.
Also the paper.
And also the paper, the different papers. The quality of the paper. Some papers just disintegrate into ashes. Some paper just burn, but it has, they are intact. So...
Only we, also we use every single thing, for we use also the ashes. For
we save
in all this process, we save in boxes, always we do, always we burn.
Hundreds of boxes.
Hundreds and hundreds of
can
boxes.
Can wonderful, meticulous attention.
The light touch we have to use.
We need to put each thing in a box. We need start put together all the boxes for the show. So we are...
And the show was, we started the summer of that year, and then we didn't. In this, the show was for the next spring, so we stopped in the middle of the winter. We couldn't burn the paper, and so we save all the paper that you have burned, and then we start in the spring. And some paper we just rolled and burned, and they became a roll. So we use different kinds of forms. But
and we're building all these
textures,
textures.
They were rolled, so you had an accordions.
But at the end,
nations.
Yeah. At the end, we really knew the final. I mean, when we start burning the paper, we knew what were the going to be the result, because we had been so familiar and had been burning so much paper that we were very familiar with the results.
And we want to use one of the more old forms in our world, which is the pyramids. So yes, we made these pyramids.
But not completely.
No, completely.
Some of them were mounds.
Yes.
Right. It looked like some kind of old landscape, ancient
structure. Yeah. Well, our background, we are... I grew up in mountains, and she too, and so it's our background.
Our
background
is with us forever.
Yes.
The rivers, the mountains, the landscape of our countries.
Beautiful.
A childhood.
Yeah, that is so important.
And the forms, and the shadows that the paper gave, and the forms were amazing, and the textures, and the
nuances.
The show was... Really, that show was amazing. For the people walk in the door and feel the smell.
And the smells.
Oh,
also,
burns.
Yeah.
Also, the sound.
So
the sound was a language.
Yeah.
A language.
Yeah.
Like a, almost like a people talking.
Like a
second
place.
Oh,
yeah.
We have an audio.
Yes.
We have an audio. Yes.
Yeah. Remember you saw.
There was the readings.
Mm-hmm.
We did the readings.
And so it was like it became, the gallery became a sacred place.
Exactly.
It was silent and it was a little
and dark.
Dark.
And almost penumbra.
Like when you enter the gallery, you feel like you couldn't talk loud. So
it was sacred.
Yeah, it became a sacred place.
We had so many phone calls and we have so many emails and all that some people cry.
They
were always
feeling.
So I have an email from a friend which she say, Fernando, I really, this bring me to my memories from my father's death and all
whatever.
That stuff.
Yeah.
What's
so
amazing.
Many reactions from
people. Yeah, we have lots of things
about reviews, and some people compare these the shapes that they were with the
atoms.
The carbon atoms, the
how is
talking
how
about
is
speaking about physics almost.
Physics, yeah.
Of the carbon.
And the properties.
The molecules.
Molecules.
The molecules.
Yes.
Yes.
The molecules.
The same forms. And they send us a photograph of these carbon molecules. And it was amazing.
Insane.
Another point of view. Which is good.
Yeah. So we have lots. The show was amazing.
In the video, I did not travel to see the show, so in the video you have the voices, so that was ongoing on a loop in the installation. And then there are the three of you seated on a bench at the end of the video, and you're all in black, and you have dark glasses and black tape over your mouths. Mm-hmm. I couldn't see if you had anything over your ears.
No.
We perform that night from the beginning to the end. We sit there, we don't move.
We are part of that installation.
Of the installation.
We did not.
The funny thing was, some people blowing our faces or touch ourselves, thinking we are wax
figures.
Or I don't know. What's funny? And we say, we are going to perform. We are not going to breathe. We are not going to move. We are not going to do anything. And Berta was fighting with us. I can't do this.
Not only this, my friend from Portugal came to see the show.
She had for 20 years.
Ann Arbor. After 20 years, I hadn't seen her. And she comes to me and she says, I want to talk to you. I want to visit. And you can't.
And she can't move very well.
It was very funny.
And you held your place.
It was very funny.
Yeah. So, in the end, it was very painful.
We tried to sit in a wooden bench.
In a wood
for
bench.
For 2.5 hours.
And don't
maybe
move.
Never again.
Yeah.
We did another installation where Fernando and I has to be in the floor in between.
Oh.
50 bodies, staff bodies, staff.
We do with...
There are the bodies.
That is part.
If you see hanging on.
Yes.
But
yes.
Those
they
were
on
the
floor.
We are
buried.
Graciela and I, we are buried.
At the Saginaw Museum. That
we have two of those bodies in the floor.
All of
but
them.
But we have
carpets.
To stay there for more than half an hour without moving, so people don't know that we are in there.
They think it's
so
a carpet.
So Fernando told me, oh, you are lazy. I'm going to be there for hours. So...
They are, Fernando and Graciela, excuse me, Graciela, are in the carpet.
We are in camouflage
with the rest of the bodies that we had constructed. Yeah.
So Berta is there singing, and when she starts
performing,
we just raise from their bodies.
And then the stooges.
Some people scream. You see, some people scream. So,
so
funny.
They were so integrated, but meanwhile, they're dying.
We're
like asphyxiation.
It was very tired. And Fernando at one moment said, start now, because I cannot think. He couldn't move. We couldn't move.
Oh
did you say
God.
That?
So all my body was asleep.
It has
amazing.
Its wonderful moments, the inside stories.
Yeah. That's where we have so much fun.
So what installation are you speaking of?
It was
of
in
the
Saginaw
Museum.
Saginaw Museum.
Oh, what year?
I don't know. What probably right after the shoes.
Right after Alpha Omega Alpha?
Right
no,
after.
Before.
It was
before,
one of the beginnings, the first installations. And you have photographs of it, the installation?
This is the only one that unfortunately we don't have.
A few
anywhere.
Photographs.
Yeah.
Then let's describe it a moment, because it sounds, there are some similarities with this Alpha Omega Alpha. Everything is in black. The bodies that you're pointing to look like almost Eva Hesse type of hanging black nylon
contortions.
Bodies.
Well,
all
was
bodies.
The show. All the show was about form, about body, body and form. So Berta, she started painting all these forms
the
and bodies.
The walls were also painted.
All the walls on the of
black,
the gallery.
Black and white.
Yeah. All the gallery was covered of this roll. We buy these big rolls of paper, photograph paper.
Photographic background.
Background paper. We cover all the walls with these paintings, where she made almost like a body movement. For that was the thing, like a dance body movements. So we want doing the performance, bury ourselves with these bodies, and in one moment became part of these bodies. So that was a performance for that show.
And you sang or you sang?
I recited, mostly sang.
Yeah, she sang.
Yes.
She is almost like a, she was like the priest.
I was the priestess. Is there a feminine for priestess?
Yes.
Is there this word
priestess? This is correct.
Yeah, she was.
Kind of.
And were you using the invented language that had even
not yet.
And you see we were using paintings, not one piece only.
Yeah.
It was
sounds. What she do was sounds, like a no
they
nothing.
Were a mixture, they were a mixture of in my mind, all at the time of voodoo's prayers, voodoo's.
All about body.
Yeah.
Yeah.
About incarnations, in the magic.
Is this something that you would have garnered from your life in your other country, your home country, or something?
Yeah,
like
well,
Brazil.
But I mean, all cultures have these devils and superstitions, but that interests me.
Okay.
Always did. Interests us.
La Macumba.
Yeah, the voodoos.
Macumba is the...
Well, that has to do with good forces and bad forces.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Always.
Yeah. Always.
Always.
That's life.
Temptation. All these things associated with bodies. See, this is not the ashes. It's a different level.
Mm-hmm.
We're going up, but the other one was legitimate, very legitimate,
yes.
And a step towards what we do.
Oh, yeah.
Everything is a
every
step.
Time that we do something, it's a
it's
step.
A step.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, we want
you have to
you
accept.
Feel like,
you have to accept looking back.
Oh yeah, it's
part.
If
of
we didn't that. We didn't do that work, we were not going to be here.
No, you don't do something else.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
that
because
nothing is wasted.
Every time that we work, make us grow.
Yeah.
And do better.
I think this is a good philosophy. It's just to sustain us. We have to put in our heads that everything is a step, and not dwell in success, faith, all these things. That doesn't matter. It's the work. I think that's very interesting and helpful in anything you do.
There is a cohesiveness about your meaning, your intentions, what it is that you're striving for. I'm not saying that it appears that you've got it etched in stone, what your intentions are, but certainly there is a wonderful cohesion amongst and between the pieces.
Ultimately, we are striving for excellence and for perfection. If we can, to be there.
It goes back to the challenge that he uses so often, because what's God given, or whatever notion you have, God of perfection, how can we dare even to attempt? But it has been done since the beginning. And why not us? These are issues that are very important, very philosophic, and very difficult, but the three of us give us force.
Yeah, we push it forward.
When you are alone, not so easy. Don't you think?
Oh, very much.
Well, we are alone, we suffer so much.
There's always because
we
the
are
word
together,
suffer. You
we
know,
support
it's like
ourselves.
Overused term.
We push ourselves. And that is so amazing.
Alone we suffer.
Yes.
Doubts.
Mm-hmm.
In your conversations that I've been privy to for two or three times, there's always that opposite of doubt. There is excitement and energy.
And that.
Yeah.
So we go from, what was the title of this installation that you did with your bodies actually on the floor? And
do you remember? I don't even remember. We'll
get to
it.
Yes.
We have all the catalogs and all that stuff. We
from
think,
dark
yeah.
to light. Was that from dark to light?
From darkness to light. I think it was
It was.
Yes.
To check.
But we'll check.
Yes.
We're concentrating.
And then we move to the book and Alpha Omega Alpha.
Mm-hmm.
And what piece did you do in the University of Dayton?
Oh, we do Bridge.
Yes. Would you speak about this?
Yes.
Bridge. We were invited to do a piece at the...
We visited the gallery.
Yes.
And we waited
yes.
for them. I also didn't discover.
We were invited to do a piece at the Dayton, the gallery.
Reich Gallery.
And
what's the name? Reich, R-I-K.
Reich Gallery. So the three of us went to Dayton and to see the gallery because we wanted to see the space. And when the lady told us, I give you this space, and she, the gallery was a little bit dark, so she turned out the lights, and we saw the shadows projected on the wall from the building, from the ceiling, from the
open air second floor rotunda gallery.
The supports, all the supports of the roof, the ceiling was
projected in the space in that the we were space. Going to use. So we loved it. It was a beautiful image on the wall. So we decided to paint the shadows and to do a reflective, and it looks almost like a bridge.
So we do the water. So we do the water with glass with glass in the floor, and also we use walls. No, we
inside the
inside
glass.
The glass.
Yes.
And also, we want to do something with the people collaborate too with the pennies, like you throw away for a
good luck. For
good luck.
You make a wish.
Make a wish
in the
water.
Pennies.
The pennies. So we put our barrel of pennies, and so
and
there
the,
is with
the viewers, the visitors came and they took a penny and make a wish and throw it into the water. So it became landscape of the bridge and the water, and also the bridge connected the gallery and the space together.
Kind of peace,
yeah,
in a way.
It was very peaceful.
Peaceful message of optimism.
There are a lot of dark and light pieces. I mean, just the color, lots of white and black in your previous work. And here, you know, when you said bridge, I had always thought you were saying breach. And for me, you were using glass, you were using water, you were using reflected light. You were finding places in between the white and the black, the light and the dark, breaking open a breach, which was also literally a bridge that you built using glass, see-through, concrete, glass blocks. So something about light, reflected light, shadows, the spaces in between black and light, any of that resonate for you?
All of it.
Light is important. Yeah. Daylight is important. We love daylight.
In contrast.
In
and
contrast.
Shadows,
and
in
the
contrast.
Shadows. The shadows is so interesting. In these pictures and all these things, the shadows with maybe
become
paper.
Part of the painting.
Yeah, it's amazing. So it's very important. Yeah,
and
for
then
it's three dimensional. That is because
you performed in that space the night of the opening, and then the next time you came back to Dayton at Archetype Gallery. Mary Rajero's gallery in Dayton, which would have been 2006, you created a huge piece that was impressive, all white paper, meticulously stitched together.
Mescu.
Braille, punching.
What language?
Yes. And you performed in that space. Would you like to make some comment on some of the meaning or intentions implicit in that piece that you did, Mesclun?
Mesclun, yeah.
It was inspired by the physical aspect of the place.
The place, that was
because there was the walls were made of metal with
perforated
metal.
Almost like a mesh.
So we got the idea from those pieces of metal to do this perforated pieces,
language, communication,
with our words, with our language, and to put them together like a quilt. But also the light was important because the piece was not against the wall, but it was separated from the wall about 2 feet. So when the the light comes from the front and projected, go through the perforations and
projected on
the wall, so you can read the walls on the wall, because the paper was all white, it was a little bit difficult to read, but when the light was projected on the wall, you can see perfectly the words. So the light was very important in this piece.
The message.
And the size was, we did the size according to the space, and it was inspired by this, by the physical. So
the space say a lot to us.
It's huge. It's like 27 feet in length.
Not only this, but the details, certain details of the aspect, just is deceived.
And what's funny, for we in the beginning want to do one only piece. How we transport this? So we think in make it squares and make a quilt. So that was born the quilt.
Yeah.
Yeah, for was too big. And also how you punch in the center after
with a huge paper.
So we research a lot. We came here in Graciela's and in her floor, and we start doing practicing and doing all that stuff.
To arrive at this size of the squares and to how to put it together and how to transport it, we have to think about all those things.
Yeah.
And we.
In the beginning, we have the idea, we want doing a huge piece with all punch and every single thing. And next we start thinking, how we are going to punch the center? How we are going to reach the other side? So that is, in the beginning, we have, the idea we want
to... And also, we wanted to do the punches to be similar with the metal that was there. But we have to investigate where to find this kind of metal puncher.
So we use styrofoam.
So we have to create a process how to do it.
We create our tools. We create our own tools.
Because we never found this metal. We went to several places and these walls, they don't...
We went buy a piece of metal, that sheet of metal, and we perforate and using almost like a stencil.
Oh, yes.
We want to do the same thing, and we don't find anywhere. Mm-hmm. And a guy with the owner of the gallery, she say where she buy the metal. And we call the people and only delivery around, I think, in $7,000 material. So we say, forget it. We need to start from the beginning. So we start research, and we start...
We came with our own tools.
And all tools.
And work
perfect. And work perfect.
Because we have to also be able to do it in the house. So we have to find a space comfortable enough to do it in the sizes. So we start doing it in a small square. Mm-hmm. 2x2?
Yeah, 2x2. No, it was 17 by 17.
Oh, 17 inches by 17 inches mm-hmm. squares.
Yeah.
And then bring us up to date to your most current piece. Is there anything else you'd want to discuss that is an important marker for you, work that you created, before we get to this new work?
Well, before this work, we have an idea in doing a piece with toilet paper. Make it a big, big quilt and cover a ceiling of a museum.
Yeah.
That was...
We did a maquette.
We made the maquette.
And the director loved the idea.
Of museum.
In Ann Arbor.
And this would be 2006?
This was...
2007?
No.
It was...
2 years ago.
2 years ago.
Yes.
We did a maquette and... The director loved the idea, but of course they have board members.
Board.
And you went to the board members, they didn't like it. They saw that it was, I don't know what was the problem.
No,
the museum was too traditional for this piece, and the board members were very traditional, so the piece was never done.
We went one day, Berta, Graciela, and I, we love going to museums and all that stuff together and all that, and we saw this ceiling and say, oh my God, this is amazing for an installation. So immediately we start talk about the space
the
and all that stuff.
The fourth ceiling was going to be weaved in paper.
In toilet paper.
We still may do it. We have a chance.
Why that upper space? Why that material?
Because there
it's a challenge.
Challenge.
Yeah.
To challenge.
It's
the
a challenge.
Lightness.
Yeah, we don't know it. We can do.
Yeah.
Only
is
we
a,
are going
we
to
know
do
if it's
going
to work or not.
Exactly. So
and
we
will make it work.
We make it work.
Somehow.
Yeah. So we're thinking in doing this huge, cover all this ceiling with this weaving piece. Yeah, that was an idea.
Well, again, you, you're challenged by materials that are light,
embracing.
Sometimes mundane, very fragile.
Fragile.
Toilet paper.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. The opposite of sacred, ash.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And yet, it's only our judgments
well,
that make
like
it so.
We like these contrasts. This is what makes it interesting and unexpected.
We come
but
from
yeah,
our countries
you know
with
what?
Our
when
weavers.
The thing would be done, it would be spiritual. Hopefully. Not mundane. The material would disappear. The material would disappear. So as this is the irony.
Well, in your hands, I can imagine toilet paper
mm-hmm.
as being filled with fibers and very
paper.
Delicate.
What's the difference between the paper? Paper, as you know, and rolled. The function.
What did I mean?
It's very noble.
And your newer piece of cheesecloth. This is like toilet paper in its interwoven. Lightness and fineness.
And healing.
Oh, so describe your new piece for those who can't see it yet. What it is being made of, how it's being manifested, and then your intentions for it.
Well, we're always looking with material, fragile materials. So we start thinking in water, we start thinking in paper, we start thinking
and
in feathers. And in one point, we talk about eggs. We're talking about the shells of the eggs.
The eggshells.
Eggshells.
We have the eggshells, and we clean them, and then we cut them precisely to form
a shape.
A receptacle.
That's a good word.
So with the cheesecloth, we weave the cheesecloth in the squares.
The base is
the cheesecloth, and we make it into squares with the stripes of cheesecloth. We make squares. And then in the middle of the squares, we glue the eggshell. But when it's all together, it doesn't look like eggshells at all.
The thing is, we start with the material, only the material don't work the same way. We don't wash the material. So she washed all the material. Became fluffy. It's amazing. So we start investigating about that. We start first looking the material. We love the material, only the material don't work like we want. So she washed all the material. And now she has all the pieces start connected, one by one.
Two inches apart, forming a square.
Forming that almost like a crosses, like a very, very...
When you're making a dress and you're gathering fabric like this and stitching it in spacing a couple of inches apart, it's called smocking.
Mm-hmm.
So it's smocked. You have what I see is this beautiful white fabric on a mannequin. It looks like almost a wedding dress. It starts from the bust, and it's simple, no sleeves, and just cascades down to what would be ankle length, somewhat of an empire waistline.
Yes.
So the smocking begins just below the breasts,
yeah.
And the smocking covers the front, a front panel from just below the breast down to the ankle. And that smocking, every smocked center has an egg shell, sort of receptacle, a little oval glued to it.
Yeah.
The color of the egg is synonymous with the color of the cheesecloth. It's all white.
Yeah.
It looks like the fabric has been made into just little flowerettes that are extremely simple.
Yeah.
It's the textures, all the textures. The fabric has a texture.
An amazing texture.
Yeah.
And shadows.
The shadows and all that stuff with the lighting. We want very mystical lighting
and
for this piece.
It looks strong, but it's extremely fragile.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
It doesn't look fragile, but it is.
And this comes from a thing where we talk about dreams. About dreams. Would you dream?
For
sometimes you are in the air. You are in the air, you're flying, you're doing all that stuff. So, for that, we want the dress be hanged. So you don't see any face, anything, or thing. It's kind of like a ghost.
Anonymous song.
Yeah.
And it's a work in progress.
It's not done.
It's not done yet.
We have the idea what we want, only maybe we change. We don't know. So it's in progress.
Well, when I first saw the dress, I realized those were eggs, and of course eggs are signs for fertility, fruitfulness, abundance. And then you refer to this as alluding to dreams.
Mm-hmm.
The piece that you did in Dayton with the bridge and actually having the students throw pennies over their back about them thinking of their wishes, their hopes, their dreams.
Mm-hmm.
Your work is very serious, very solemn, very sacred, but it's also this uplifting hopefulness.
Always.
Mm-hmm.
This is what we want.
And this looks like a very, well, it is uplifting. She's floating.
Mm-hmm.
A beautiful cascade of light.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very hopeful, very uplifting. She has a train of twisted cord that almost looks like an umbilical cord. It doesn't look like a veil. Mm-hmm. And you say, that's going to be a mile long? What is your thinking?
That is an idea.
Approximately. And it will be many strings, not one, more.
Oh.
First, we need to find the place to put
Once
this.
We find the space.
We want a big, big space with many rooms, maybe, so that string is going to walk all the place, all the rooms, and we want to put the nest
at the end
in a corner
of the trail. There will be more things.
Yeah,
but it may change.
It may change.
Maybe we go.
Depends on the space. We have to find the space for this.
And have you found a material for the nest? Will it be gauze also?
Maybe gauze. We don't know yet. Yeah, maybe gauze. Maybe we change our minds. I don't know.
We have to see. We have to actually win it and then see if we.
It has to brew.
This takes now so long, no? We working with this piece for almost what?
1 year.
One year. For we made first the mannequin is not we don't want now that form. We are going to change completely the mannequin now.
Mm-hmm.
For it's not working with the piece. So the idea born 1 year ago. So it's in process.
Are these a part of the installation, these two?
No.
Okay. Well, you've been together a year now. Are you celebrating your 10-year? Do you reflect on your history, where you've come and where you find yourselves now and where you think you're going?
Yes,
much more. We know much more what we're doing. But we felt the same in the beginning.
Yeah.
It's so interesting.
But we are more thankful that we are working together, that we can work together.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not always easy with the family.
Oh.
There's so many sacrifices. And we are able to travel a little bit, not a lot, not as much as we would like to, but still we are thankful that we can do it.
Mm-hmm.
And we can have time to do it, and at this time and continue to do it. It's very important. And are very happy to do that.
It's very important.
And it's so nice to be documented in this way that you are offering us. Very, very lucky.
We're very lucky and find you. Or you find us, or whatever.
Finally, I had you talk your heads off with a final question that I would be interested in, is having you discuss your work within the larger Latino art community here and abroad, and the contemporary art community here and abroad. Who are your influences? How do you feel you fit? Where is your artistic community outside of this collaboration?
All over the world.
Yeah.
We go to meetings, we look at magazines, we read papers.
Newspaper,
and
books.
We're so surprised to see things that are exhibited now, it's the truth, in installation form that we have done in years ago. So that means we are on top of this.
The last thing was we saw was Doris Salcedo. And,
did you hear about it?
Graciela went and saw the show.
I saw
and
the piece.
The crack? The installation, yeah. So, it's...
But inevitably, we are from Latin America, and our culture has influenced us, but our work is universal. It's not
we only...
We are Latin artists, but our work is
universal. It's not only our background. It's everything. It's every day. No? It's how you wake up. It's how you go into bed. It's everything. See?
Yeah. Again, we have our roots that will never, will be always with us, luckily.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But it's transformed and it's the world. And with this communications that we have now,
yes,
with the computers, and it's amazing.
It's amazing. We can find
the images.
Anything.
My husband will come. We come and see the latest bridges that this particular architect did. We see in a minute. Then you see antiquities. And you just, it's amazing.
I fascinated for the work of Martin Pureguer.
Yes.
I love his work. For me, it's my idol. Martin Pureguer.
Oh, I just saw his work in California.
He is my hero now. I have lots of heroes. It's
my hero is Richard Serra.
Hero is Richard Serra.
I love his work.
Yeah,
it's amazing.
It's amazing how our minds change. I remember when in my beginnings, I loved Rodin and all the sculpture of Rodin and all that stuff. And after that, disappeared completely Rodin. For I say, I really not.
Because
love
you
Rodin
have
more.
Photos, you have digitals, you have...
Henry Moore, Louis Nevelson, so many different
influences, but they were so important.
Yeah,
they registered the epoch.
It's very
they
important.
Registered the
and
era.
Also that see the work push you to continue, inspire you to continue work and say, oh my God, what are you doing now? I need to do something else. Yeah.
Very much focused on abstraction, but also eliciting a physical response. And it's through that careful attention to craftsmanship, to the making of the image. The Gestalt qualities of Richard Serra, it's abstract, but it's always meant to challenge and awaken the viewer to the immediacy of the environment. And your work does that.
Exactly.
And I think anyone familiar with your work or now becoming familiar with your work will see how important this constant flux of streaming communications that connect us around the globe are at the center of your thematics.
Exactly.
Your work is
progressing. You can't escape. It's around you. It's in you.
Richard Bacon,
many times not
too. Richard Bacon.
Bacon?
No, Bacon. I love his work too. It's amazing. All the forms, very organic. So
that makes sense.
Yeah, it's very important. We are not alone in this world. We have many things to inspire ourselves.
Oh, yeah.
So that is important. Every single day.
Thank you for your good conversation. Invite me
to
your next performance.
Okay.
Installation.
Of course.